ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायणं नमस्कृत्य नरं चैव नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततो जयमुदीरयेत्। नष्टप्रायेषु अभद्रेषु नित्यं भागवत सेवया भगवतीरुत्तमश्लोके भक्तिर्भवति नैष्टिकी। कृष्णाय वासुदेवाय देवकी नंदनाय च नंदगोपकुमाराय गोविंदाय नमो नमः। सो टुडे वी आर रीडिंग फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम 10th कैंटो 83rd चैप्टर। द्रौपदी मीट्स द क्वींस ऑफ कृष्णा। टेक्स्ट नंबर 24। मत्स्याभासम जले विक्ष्य ज्ञात्वा च तदवस्थितिं पार्थो यत्तो सृजद् बाणं नाच्छिन्नत् नाच्छिन्नत्। एक मिनट। पस्पर्शे पस्पृशे परम मत्स्याभासं जले विक्ष्य ज्ञात्वा च तदवस्थितिं पार्थो यत्तो सृजद् बाणं नाच्छिन्नत् पस्पृशे परम मत्स्याभासं जले विक्ष्य ज्ञात्वा च तदवस्थितिं पार्थो यत्तो सृजद् बाणं नाच्छिन्नत् पस्पृशे परम। माता जी नाचिन्नत् पस्पृशे परम
मत्स्य।
यस गो गो इट। मत्स्याभासं जले विक्ष्य ज्ञात्वा च तदवस्थितिं पार्थो यत्तो सृजद् बाणं नाचिनत्पस्पृशे परम मत्स्य ऑफ द फिश आभासम द रिफ्लेक्शन जले इन द वॉटर वीक्ष्य लुकिंग एट ज्ञात्वा नोइंग च एंड तत् इट्स अवस्थितिम लोकेशन पार्थः अर्जुन यत्तः टेकिंग केयरफुल एम असृजत शॉट बाणम द एरो न आच्छिनत ही डिड नॉट पियर्स इट पस्पृशे ही टच्ड इट परम ओनली ट्रांसलेशन देन अर्जुन लुक्ड एट द रिफ्लेक्शन ऑफ द फिश इन द वॉटर and determined its position. When he carefully shot his arrow at it, however, he did not pierce the target, but merely grazed it. Purport. According to the explanation of Srila Sridhar Swami, Arjun was more expert a marksman than the other kings. But his physical strength was not adequate to the task of shooting it with perfect accuracy. Hare Krishna. Om Agyanatimirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Sri Guruve Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam श्री कृष्णा चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम राम राम, राम हरे हरे सो आई एम ग्रेटफुल टू ऑल ऑफ यू थैंक यू वेरी मच Srimad Bhagavatam is now at a very interesting marriage stories are coming up. The transcendental marriages. And Draupadi is meeting the queens of Krishna and inquiring from them how they got married with Krishna. Usually these topics are in the material world, they're like gossip, love affairs and how they got united, how they got broken away, how they again got reunited with somebody else. And this tendency is too strong in the material world to know what's happening in somebody's personal life. But when the same tendency, that is called as curiosity or inquisitiveness, that is there in everybody, it's not something sinful to have that curiosity or inquisitiveness. But what that is used for knowing worldly things, things of sense gratification, things of sense titillation, then it becomes a source of degradation and takes us to hell actually, eventually. But lo and behold, when this tendency is connected with Krishna, then the same inquisitiveness and curiosity, we touch with Krishna. What happens is the manifestation of wonderful divine transcendental pastimes of Sri Krishna are revealed through that inquisitiveness, and it simply gives you joy, happiness and bliss, and ultimately leads you to the supreme abode of Krishna. That is the beauty of this. Sri Krishna is glorified as Triloka Gitaha, one whose glories are sung, Gitaha, sung in all the three worlds, not only in this universe, but all the universes, all the three worlds, his glories are being sung. When such topics are being discussed, such inquisitiveness is expressed, we get transformed. It gets transformed into a purifying activity when connected with Krishna. So that's how Draupadi is actually bringing out the nectar from the lotus mouths of the queens of Sri Krishna. It is said there was a kingdom called Sindhu Nad, a spotless dynasty of Sindhunad on the western side, Paschimatya Desh. And there was a king called Brihatsena. He was the king of Madra Desh. And he had a daughter called Lakshmana. This daughter was very unique. Right from beginning she was in love with Krishna. And somehow, out of the Vedic culture, there was shyness. But you know something, it is, what is overwhelming you in your mind has to be expressed somewhere. Like when Usha was having some relationship with Aniruddha, it was expressed through her body. And the sensitive people, intelligent people could understand the changes in their body, which they concluded that something is in this direction. So like that, Lakshmana couldn't contain the overwhelming loving affection for Krishna. And the whole day she would hide it and not express it. So where would it express itself? In the dream. So many times when you have a young girl or young boy at home, if you are awake when the child is sleeping, boy is sleeping and girl is sleeping, you can watch very nicely what they are speaking. Whatever there is the inner core of the heart, they are speaking in the night in the dream. So what is Lakshmana speaking? Which her mother heard. She's saying, "Oh Surya Dev, please let me get married to my lovable object Sri Krishna, like Kalindi got married, like your daughter got married. Please let me also get married. This beautiful young man with complexion like a dark cloud always is smiling at me constantly." So mother was very puzzled actually. She told her husband, "Our daughter is speaking like this incoherently in dreams. What we should do?" So father understood that she is talking about Krishna in the dreams. So he made a Swayambara in such a way that only Sri Krishna can win it. The difference, it was similar to Arjuna's Swayambara, that is Draupadi's Swayambara, sorry. And there was a fish and it was revolving and there was water pond below and many things, you know. Many technical, today we cannot even imagine such kind of puzzle actually. We can read in Bhagavatam, but still difficult to conceive what kind of puzzle was there, what kind of situation was there. But what we understand from description here is that the difference was that Arjuna's lakshya, target was open and this target was closed from all sides. Only what you could see it in the water. Arjuna could see when he saw also like that. But this was not possible to be seen. It was more complicated and more intricate. And so it was made that whoever will pierce the fish, he will win the hand of Lakshmana. Now, many kings like Jarasandha, Shishupal, Bhima, Duryodhan, Karna, they all came there. Many, many big people. And the target, the whole task was so difficult that many just couldn't attempt only. They were thinking, "This is too difficult, why to put us to shame?" So they didn't attempt only. But people who thought they were strong and they were skillful, like Jarasandha, Shishupal, Bhima, everybody came. The difference was, many had great strength because there was also a bow which was very, very heavy. It was not that only piercing skillfully was important. When the bow was very important, it had to be lifted, it had to be strung, it had to be pulled, aimed and released. There are so many steps. Some of them were very strong, they could lift the blow. Some of them could lift, could tie the string but could not pull it. And the bow just reflected in such a huge way, like the rubber, you know, elastic, how it just goes back and hits you. They fell down miserably, people laughed at them. And some of them were very skillful but did not have enough strength to lift the bow. So, I remember my father, in my childhood, had told me this. I just remembered this. He said that a living entity can always excel in one thing in life. At the most, two or three things. Excel, really become excellent, you know, specialist. But one cannot become excellent in every single thing in life. You cannot claim that you are good at every single thing what you do, or you try to do, or attempt to do, or dream to do. But Sri Krishna is the only personality, supreme personality of Godhead. He is excellent in everything that he does, he wants to do, is excellent. So then it is said that Karna was about to win, but he couldn't aim. Then Arjuna came. I mean, he thought Arjuna could do it. Let us say that Arjuna was extremely skillful in archery, but he did not have that much enough strength. He was very strong, but didn't have that much enough strength to do the needful. So he did everything, but still his arrow just brushed the target and went away. He didn't hit the target, he didn't break the target and make it fall down, like generally which should happen. And then Sri Krishna came. So the explanation is that why Arjuna could not do it, because Arjuna ultimately is a living entity, the great devotee of the Lord. There's a difference between living entity and the Supreme Lord. At other time he pierced the fish when he won Draupadi's hand. But this time it was Sri Krishna's time. It was Sri Krishna's glory to be exhibited. So Krishna pierced the field. See, it is said that all of the kings who gathered there, they were really full of pride and full of arrogance, and also they were envious, like Shishupal, Jarasandha. So it is said Krishna, when he hit the target very skillfully, there was a tumultuous sound created by that, by the hitting of the arrow to the fish, and everything broke down. He said that sound tumultuously, you know, hit all the three worlds and shattered the hearts of all the envious people and gave great joy to the hearts of people who are favorable to Sri Krishna. This phenomenon is seen everywhere. When the conch shells were blown in the Mahabharata war, it terrorized the hearts of all the envious people. Whichever, this party or that party. It's not that you ought to be in this party or that party. Whoever was not favorable to Krishna, was inimical to Krishna, their hearts were shattered. And whoever were devotees to Krishna, even the volume, decibels, everything was same, but it invigorated them. It gave them strength. There was no fear in their heart. It gave them spiritual energy. It was so joyous. So when this sound came up, all demigods and devotees became very happy. All the envious souls became terrorized by the sound of Krishna's baking the fish. It broke 2-3 attractive coverings and pierced the heart of the fish. And the friction called so much sound in all three worlds. Jai, Jai, all demigods exclaimed, Jai, Jai. And there was Pushpa Vrishti from the skies. All the demigods showered flowers at the Abhijin Muhurta. It's a very auspicious noon Muhurta. Whenever there is marriage, Abhijin Muhurta is in at the noon time. Fine music with all wonderful equipments were resounding on the skies and also above the sky on earth and on all the heavenly planets. Demigods were enjoying, dancing, throwing flowers, and musical instruments were playing. And at that time, Lakshmana, with her head lowered, with great shyness, great joy in the heart, because all that she was dreaming all this while, all that she was speaking all this while in the dreams, all that she was desiring and praying for, that moment had come of fulfillment. That moment of fulfillment is extremely important for all of us also. We all are aiming, desiring, dreaming, praying for that we should meet Krishna one day and end all this bad dream. Imagine the day when we will also be able to see Krishna face to face, as Gurudev mentions, that if we are perfectly situated, then we will see Krishna face to face at the moment of death. The pain of death will not affect us so much. The joy of seeing Krishna will overwhelm us. And the pain of death, which is so overwhelming, will become insignificant. So that moment of achievement, of fulfillment of life, of meeting Supreme Lord as her husband, came. And she came with a garland made of gold and jewels like diamonds. Dazzlingly shining, she came up and she garlanded Krishna. Gopal Champu, Jiva Goswami explains that when this was happening, she was coming down. She was glowing pink from all sides. It's like pink abha. Pink effulgence was coming out of her lotus feet, her hands, her eyes and her face. Like she was walking like a pink color was walking, effulgent. It was creating joy in the hearts of devotees and creating envy and anger in the hearts of people who were unhappy because they could not win her hand. Sri Krishna very gracefully placed her on her chariot. It's like, you know, there's not much time there. Like he came, he saw Rukmini, he just picked her up put her on chariot and just started going. No time to waste. So as soon as this happened, she garlanded, immediately lifted her and put her in the garland. It is said that Sri Krishna manifested four arms at this stage. And with two arms he lovingly embraced his new bride, and in two arms he held bow and arrow. Because sure enough, you know, every such kind of thing where many expectants are waiting and only one is the winner, there has to be some action. So that's sure enough it happened. Many people got angry and they attacked Krishna. And he said, Krishna immediately within few minutes created a full mess of blood and arms and severed heads with helmets and arms with weapons and blood and flesh everywhere. Very peacefully he turned and started going away. Then Brihatsena was very happy. He also accompanied Krishna with a huge army. And there was a grand wedding in Dwarka in the presence of Brihatsena and his whole kingdom's army and relatives and friends in Dwarka. So Lakshmana is a very wonderful personality. You know, the uniqueness of these all queens who are narrating their wedding with Sri Krishna, that nobody is thinking that they were qualified. No one was thinking. Everybody is thinking, you know, I was unworthy. What to do? My heart was overwhelmed. So I was constantly praying. I don't know whether I was going to be successful or not. But he was so kind and merciful. He came all the way to fulfill my desire. He responded to the desire of my heart very favorably. He came and even though I was unworthy, he held my hand and accepted me. He also desired to participate in this Swayamvara. It was his kindness, not my qualification. So all of us should imbibe this mood actually. We are not qualified for receiving the holy name, but it is a causeless mercy. We are not qualified to meet devotees, but we have been blessed with that. We have been allowed to participate into the pure devotional service, you know, taught by all the great acharyas. We have been connected with all the acharyas, the Supreme Personality of Godhead through the parampara. We have been introduced to holy name, to the holy dham, to the devotional service that we can perform with our wretched senses, sinful senses. And we have been blessed with initiation by spiritual master. No one should ever feel that I did my hard work, I became qualified. That's why they approved my name and they gave me initiation. Although all this is on practical level true, we were approved, but actually all that initiation and the holy name that we have received is only a blessing. Causeless mercy of the Lord. And if tomorrow by the grace of the Guru Maharaj, if we achieve Sri Krishna and his abode, it's also causeless mercy. The endeavor is maybe 100% our side, but that 100% of our endeavor is never enough to meet Krishna. The endeavor of the Gilehari, the squirrel, was 100% in throwing some sands, particles of sand in the Setu of Lord Ramchandra, but it could have been never enough to complete the Setu of Lord Ram. But still, looking at the 100% surrender at the hearts of devotees, Sri Krishna fulfills the desire of devotees. That is our great fortune, that all our 100% efforts are so tiny and insignificant. Still, overwhelmingly, lovingly, he responds to our desire. And that is our good luck, that we have such a Lord and such a Gurudev who causelessly bestow their blessings upon us. This is the mood of the queen, including Lakshmana. Now, Jiva Goswami further goes on explaining that the gopis were so eager to meet Krishna, but they were in Vrindavan. They didn't want to leave Vrindavan because Krishna never wanted to leave Vrindavan. So it is said that they would have gone insane otherwise. But what they did, they themselves expanded in the form of queens of Krishna. And Jiva Goswami gives a full list. Who became whom? Interestingly, Chandravali became Rukmini. Radharani became Satyabhama. Vishakha Devi became Kalindi. Lalita Devi became Jambavati. And Shama Devi became Lakshmana. Shaibya became Mitravinda. Bhadravali became Bhadra. And Padma Devi became Satya Devi. These are the descriptions of eight. And it is said that as generally, you know, in the summer, we are all burning from all sides. Or even feet are also burning. It is said when you apply coconut oil or sandalwood oil, you know, with nice pot of bronze and massage your lotus feet. Your eyes became very cool. Now, how when you massage some cool oil on the sole of your feet, how eyes become cool? That is the scientific Ayurvedic reason behind it, how it happens. So you're applying something somewhere and the effect is felt somewhere, and then you go to sleep because your brain becomes very cool and you go to sleep. It is said like that, as rubbing of the oil on cool oil on feet soothes the eyes, the gopis felt some happiness in serving Krishna in the form of these queens indirectly, and thus saving themselves from going insane. What a beautiful, you know, Jiva Goswami explains so beautifully actually. The example is so perfect and so nice. They are in Vrindavan, they have expanded and become the queens. They are not directly serving Krishna, but in the form of queens they are serving Krishna. And whatever joy Krishna is receiving over that, they are receiving soothing effect over here, and they are saving themselves from becoming insane. So, gopis and queens of Krishna are one in their bhava. Their bhava remains same. The rasa is little different. Dwarka rasa is Aishwarya Sampanna, and Braj rasa is Madhurya, and more of separation, and there is some union is there. Union is existing there. But the essential bhava of loving servitude is common in its excellence, in its best situation, that is common. The loving sentiment that they had is not different. The rasa is also same in one sense, but one is Aishwarya, they are meeting with Aishwarya Sampanna Krishna out of Vrindavan, and one is Sri Krishna, the same personality, full of exhibiting Madhurya, not exhibiting Aishwarya so much. So situation is different, but the essential bhava, the sthayi bhava is same. So what we should understand from this, that wherever we go and whatever service we do, sometimes our service may be very, you know, recognizable. People will note it, oh wonderful, 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 you're doing such wonderful. And sometimes we may do service which nobody even bothers to even find out what's happening. But in both the situations, whether we get recognition or not, whether we are in this or that situation, good or bad situation, favorable or unfavorable situation, and whatever service we do in those different kind of situations, we should never give up that bhav of humble servitude. Keep our bhav humble and in service, and be grateful for that significant or insignificant seva that we are receiving as causeless mercy of the Lord. It is not that when Sri Krishna is pleased with us, and this is what just His Holiness Radhanath Swami spoke on Sunday. It is not that when Sri Krishna is pleased with you through your little endeavor, it is not that you get fame or money or property or position or increment or promotion. That is not Krishna's ways of reciprocating. It may just happen by chance as a byproduct of our service. But the real reciprocation of Sri Krishna is the opportunity to serve that He gives us. And when we pick up that opportunity with great responsibility and great feeling and gravity, then we achieve the pleasure of Krishna, which will ultimately purify us and take us back to Him. This is what Sri Krishna is explaining. So that bhav has to be maintained. Generally in material world, we are eager to do something which is has a good recognition, you know. Naturally, it's not sinful to have that feeling. It's our tendency, naturally. But in spiritual world and spiritual realm that we are dwelling in, it is not exactly what you do, whether it is recognizable or not, is important. What is important is our bhav, because that is what Sri Krishna is noticing. Sri Krishna is not noticing whether you are doing recognizable services or insignificant services. His attention is not like that. His attention is at your heart, with what mood and consciousness one is performing the service. And that we should aspire to achieve for. I want to have that mood which will attract Krishna, which will actually not attract Krishna also, but will please Krishna. Hold the endeavor of our chanting Hare Krishna, doing our services, following rules and regulations, following tapasya principles like austerities of fastings and everything, whatever we do, the ultimate purpose is not even pleasing us by that, deriving happiness and satisfaction. Ultimate purpose of all these things is to please Krishna, irrespective of my happiness, irrespective of my pleasure or satisfaction, or irrespective of my getting noted or recognized or not. And that we should aspire for. That is the essence of Krishna consciousness. So, thank you very much. Today is also the disappearance day of our beloved great personality Srivas Thakur. Our humble obeisances at the lotus feet of such a great personality. He is the incarnation of Narad Muni, and also he is incarnation Shaktyavesha avatar as a pure devotee. He was born in Sri Hatta, but with eagerness to associate and serve Lord Chaitanya, he moved to Navadvip, knowing well he was going to be there. He was very senior actually. Maybe contemporary, he was in contemporary with Advaita Acharya. And he and his brother was Sri Ram. Sri Ram was also incarnation of Parvat Muni. And Narad Muni and Parvat Muni happened to be very close friends. So they appeared together. And the most important thing for us is his house, Srivas Acharya's house, Srivas Angan, as famously known as, is the location where Lord Krishna decided to exhibit his Rasalila Bhav in Kali Yuga in the form of Harinam Sankirtan. That is what is the most relevant and important thing for us. None of us is qualified to, you know, even imagine one will be there in Rasalila someday, which is the highest exhibition of Sri Krishna's love for a living entity, which he expresses. But it was very restricted, private affair, secluded affair. Everybody couldn't, even the coward boys were pure devotees, Yashoda was a pure devotee, couldn't enter in that. Lo and behold, Sri Krishna's kindness, which manifested in the form of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you know, compelled him, overwhelmed him to exhibit that same bhav to everybody of us at that great location of Srivas Acharya's house, where he made that treasure of love manifest and available to each and every conditioned, pure or purest devotees. To everybody he made it available. He actually, that became the srot, the beginning, the ugam of that mercy, which actually then spread all over the universes. Maybe in this time in Kali Yuga, in this universe. So his house is a very beautiful place actually. It may look like some cement structure is there here and there. But that is the place where Lord Chaitanya chose to begin his glorious Harinam Sankirtan, which is the Premdhan of Goloka. Srivasan, his wife Malini, were very close friends with Jagannath Mishra and Sachi Devi, who were situated in Yogapit, you know, in Navadvip. They both were present when Lord took birth as Nimai under the tree. Especially mentioned, Malini, the wife of Srivas Pandit, helped Sachi Devi to raise Nimai, great love and affection. She actually guided her. Nimai, when he grew up, he considered Srivas Pandit and Malini as his parents. He had the same rasa. And then, long story is there, of course, Nimai was naughty and very, very offensive in one sense to all the devotees, you know, trying to make arrogant Pandit situations, and everybody was praying when he will become a devotee, when he will become a devotee. Suddenly he went to Gaya one day to do Shraddha of his father, and he met Ishwarpuri and he came back totally transformed. And he began his Sankirtan at Srivas Pandit's house. And this enraged Kaji, the local Muslim leader, government leader. And of course, when Chaitanya Mahaprabhu began his Sankirtan, in the beginning he had in daytime, but closed doors. And then he said, why should you sleep in the night? You should not sleep in the night. Why waste time in sleeping? I mean, if it's asked to me, I will be a little puzzled, you know. I need sleep 7 hours a day. But devotees exclaimed, yes, yes, why should we sleep in the lap of Maya? So night Kirtan began. And it was like the sounds which were coming from inside out were very intoxicating sounds, you know, very attracting sounds, and it was creating a lot of curiosity in everybody's heart who were outside, and they were knocking the door, but they were not allowed. And these Brahmanas became envious, and these Brahmanas started discussing, you know, they are all drinking wine and having womanization, gambling. That's why all these kind of sounds are, you know, of ecstasy when enjoying bodies are coming out. So then Kazi got notified by them. Some of them informed Kazi, some of them informed out of any. And Kazi was enraged, and he was sending 2 boatloads of soldiers to attack Srivas Pandit's house and all the devotees who were daring to do this. So the Brahmana said, see, now 2 boatloads of Kazi are coming. I mean, the soldiers are coming. We had told before only this Srivas is a big crook. His house should be uprooted and thrown in Ganga en masse, along with all the devotees who are attempting to do all these activities with him. This is envious people, you know. See, uprooting a house and throwing in the Ganga is a, even the concept is so horrible actually. किसी का घर उखाड़ के नदी में फेंक देंगे. इट्स लाइक वेरी हॉरिबल थॉट. बट एनवी इज सच अ थिंग, यू नो, वी कैन मेक यू थिंक लाइक एनीथिंग. तो श्रीवास पंडित हर्ड दिस काजी सेंडिंग सोल्जर्स एंड दे वर वेरी क्रूएल पीपल. दे वर नॉट लाइक वेरी नाइसली डिस्कसिंग विथ यू एंड कन्विंसिंग यू स्टॉप द एक्टिविटीज. दे वर गोइंग टू किल पीपल एंड हेट पीपल एंड एंजॉय देम. सो इमीडिएटली वेंट इन दिस हाउस एंड स्टार्टेड वर्शिपिंग नरसिंहदेव. एट द सेम टाइम काजी केम देयर एक्चुअली and broke the mridanga. He said, dare you all do these activities here. I will not leave you, make you, leave any of you alive. I'll kill all of you, destroy all of you. Be careful. I warn you this time. And he broke the mridanga, which is a symbol of your devotional service, equipment which is used in the Haridam, very Haridam Sankirtan. So it caused a lot of threat, you know, very terror. You're worshipping Lord Narsingadev. And Kazi threatened him and he left from there towards Shantipur, I mean towards Rajapur, that side. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was coming in the banks of Ganga. He was in ecstasy, he saw the cows and he became in the mood of Gopal and started ecstasy, started shouting as he was Gopal. He looked at Kazi, but he ignored him. Kazi also looked at him, but he ignored him and they went. Each crossed each other and then Lord Chaitanya came, Lord Nimayan Pandit came in the house of Srivas and he said, I am he. Who are you worshipping? The person whom are you worshipping is here. Lord was in total ecstasy. I left Vaikuntha to the loud calls of you and Advaita Acharya. I was sleeping at the Karana Sagar. You woke me up and now I am here. I have come to protect the pious and punish the miscreants. I will protect all of you, do not fear, from the terrors of Kazi. Offer me prayers, Srivas, offer me prayers. Srivas was awestruck and in ecstasy was trembling to see the mood of Lord Chaitanya. And immediately offered prayers and worshipped Lord Chaitanya, Nimai Pandit. And then the first civil disobedience movement began from the very house of Srivas Pandit. We will not go in details of that. And then Lord subdued Kazi and everything was fine. So, the day before Vyas Puja and Vyasa Purnima, Nityananda Prabhu arrived in Navadvip. And all of you know the story. Lord Chaitanya told that there is one personality I saw in the dream. He was wearing blue dress, wearing gada, asking, where is Gauranga? Where is Nimai Pandit's house? Please go and find him. But nobody could find him. And then Lord Chaitanya himself went and found him in the house of Nandan Acharya. And the next day of that was Vyas Purnima. So Nityananda Prabhu was called. And everybody wanted Srivas Pandit organized to celebrate Vyas Purnima. And he gave the garland of to be offered to Vyas to Nityananda Prabhu and told him, offer it to Vyasadeva, please. He said, So please offer it to Vyasa. Yes, yes. Please offer it to Vyasa. Yes, yes. He's not offering only. So he's a very weird personality. He's not listening or not understanding. Nobody knows. And then soon, Lord Gauranga appeared there. We arrived there. And again he said, please offer this garland to Vyasadeva. And Lord Nityananda straight went and offered it to Lord Chaitanya, Lord Gauranga. And Lord Gauranga then was offered all the worship of Vyasadeva. So he wanted to tell, who is the chief Vyasadeva? Who is the real Vyasadeva is Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. This happened in the house of Srivas Pandit. Then another day, Lord Gauranga assumed, the same night by the way, the same night on the same day, Lord Chaitanya had dancing in the house of Srivas Pandit and he assumed the mood of Balaram. And he said, bring me wine. Balaram was wondering what to do today. How do we bring the wine? We are not supposed to have wine. The Lord is demanding, bring me wine. So what to do? They looked at each other. Srivas Pandit said, bring water of Ganga. So many pots of waters of Ganga were brought. And Lord Gauranga drank it as Varuni. And he became intoxicated as Lord Balaram. He drank the water as if it was wine. Another day, he came in the mood of Krishna. He said, feed me food. So Srivas Pandit immediately started running here and there. This is all happening in the middle of the night. Suddenly in the mood, in the middle of the night changes. Give me food. So they brought some food. He said, no, give me more. And then they brought so many sweetmeats, juices and liquids and sweets and savories and many things. He said, Kichu Deo Khai. Hundreds of preparations brought, give me more. They didn't know what to do in the middle of the night. Now we have given hundreds of items, already has consumed in seconds. So then suddenly somebody remembered, they brought some tulsi leaves and offered him. He ate them and he was very happy. Then Lord Chaitanya, Lord Gauranga asked Suhas Pandit, why do you entertain Nityananda? Who knows his caste from where he has come? Which caste? What activity? He is so weird personality. Do you know his background? How can you entertain such a person? You are a Brahmin. You are supposed to interact with people with great study of background. This personality is not a fit person to live in your house. Please do not entertain, otherwise I will leave your association. Suhas Pandit said, my Lord, why are you testing me? Lord Nityananda is your expansion. Don't test me this way. I am your servant, my Lord. And anyone whom I see serving you becomes my worshipable master. Even if Lord Nityananda is a meat-eating drunkard, see the statements of Srivas Pandit, see the faith, the level of conviction. Even if Lord Nityananda is a meat-eater drunkard, and even if I were to lose everything material and spiritual and pious, which I think I possess, I will still not give up the lotus feet of Lord Nityananda. And Lord Chaitanya said, Hari Bol, Hari Bol! You have understood the real secret of Lord Nityananda. I am grateful to you, Srivas. Then of course, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did not exhibit that he is Lord at many times, very few times, and that very privately exhibited. And the greatest story of his exhibition is Mahaprakash, the Sat Prahari Leela, 21 hours pastime. That also fortunately took place in the house of Srivas Pandit. You can see Srivas Pandit is such a great personality. What all things Lord chose to perform in his house, and he chose to perform Mahaprakash Leela. And then see the first thing what Lord Chaitanya did. He said, call Dukhi. Where is Dukhi? Please call her. And nobody even noticed Dukhi. Who is Dukhi? You may have many servants at home. The king may have, a rich man may have, Brahmin may have, so many servants. No, nobody notices who is who, from which village, what age. Nobody knows. They called Dukhi. They are looking here and there. Only Srivas knew. He brought her. She was only bringing pots of Ganga Jal every day as per the need. Lord said, Dukhi, from today you are Sukhi. And she became ecstatic, filled with tears of love and ecstasy in front of the eyes of all devotees. They were all wonderstruck. What mercy. Then there was a tailor of Srivas Pandit, and he was a Muslim. Lord said, bring him. Lord said, dance in ecstasy, chant in ecstasy. He became ecstatic. Then there was a 4-year-old niece of Srivas Pandit called Narayani. And Lord said, Narayani, just removed from his mouth, already, what do you call, chewed betel nut. Paan khaya hota na? Already it is in the mouth. He removed it and put it in the mouth of Narayani and said, Narayani, chant and cry in ecstasy. Narayani became completely ecstatic, started dancing in ecstasy, calling the names of the Lord, and she fell unconscious over there. Why does this all happen? Because they were all connected with Lord, with Srivas Pandit. Whoever is connected with a devotee of the Lord becomes extremely dear to the Lord. And whoever serves a devotee, however insignificant he must be, he becomes very dear to the Lord and becomes the object of the mercy of the Lord. So then, after this, after giving blessing to Dukhi, Lord Chaitanya said, Srivas, do you remember when you were in the assembly of Devananda Pandit, when he was giving Bhagavatam class, and you had some devotional, sentimental expression, and he was condemning you and disturbing you, and he threw you out? At that time, I descended from Vaikuntha and made you weep in ecstatic love for me. It was me who actually entered in your heart and made you experience ecstasy in your heart while you were being insulted by Devananda Pandit. Then Brahmachari, who drank milk and fruits, only eat fruits, was hiding one day. Srivas thought, he is also a very great personality. The Lord said, Today I'm not getting happiness in my kirtan. Is there anything wrong? Is there anybody here who is not supposed to be here? Then Srivas has to be honest. Yes, my lord. I thought this brahmachari is so austere. He drinks milk only and he only eats fruits. I thought he must be getting, should be getting your mercy. So do you think just by performing austerities like drinking milk and eating fruits only is the eligibility to enter this kirtan to receive love of God? No, this is not correct. No one should feel that by performing austerities one will attain Krishna Prem. One will attain Krishna Prem only by serving a devotee and surrendering to the lotus feet of the Lord. No austerity, no rules and regulation. It will only make a person hard-hearted. So, Srivas Thakur said, you get out from this place because I think I made a mistake. So, Brahmachari was very unhappy and he was going out. But he thought he was so fortunate and he was feeling so grateful that even a glimpse of the sound which I heard of the kirtan while remaining in the same place is my great fortune, although I am unqualified as per Lord Chaitanya. And he was leaving the home gratefully. That gratitude in the heart of a brahmachari attracted attention of Lord Chaitanya. I said, call him back. And then he was taken in the sankirtan, full-fledged, openly, and he enjoyed the bliss and ecstasy of love of Godhead in the ultimate level. This happened in the house of Srivas. Then one time Srivas Pandit's mother-in-law was hiding in the basket. She thought, I am the mother-in-law of Srivas Pandit, who is the host of this whole thing? I should be getting. Lord Chaitanya again stopped. He said, who is there? So he was not knowing. This brahmachari he was knowing, but he was not knowing. So he searched, he opened the basket, he found her mother-in-law. He held her and took It's very difficult activity for anybody to do. But he actually told and removed her from the Sankirtan Mandal, that area. And Lord Chaitanya said in Mahaprakash to Srivas Pandit, ask whatever you want. I have given you already, but still you ask. I'm so happy with you. Srivas Pandit didn't start thinking about, oh, what's remaining? I should ask now. See how hard of a devotee is. He's always paropakari. Always when something is available, the devotees think of others who don't have it or who should be receiving it. We will think how I should receive whatever is the best thing in the world, and devotees will think what others should be receiving. There's an opportunity here to receive something great. So immediately Lord Srivas Pandit told Lord Gauranga, please bless your mother. The whole Mahaprakash Lila took place, but we did not see your mother receiving the blessings and the mercy. Please bless her. He said, no, I will not bless my mother. She is an offender. She has offended a devotee. She thought ill about Advaita Acharya, that he was the cause of Vishwarup leaving home. He is the culprit. He was the one who actually instigated him to leave home and put me into so much sorrow. So then, you know, he was waiting and she was also crying. Then she went and Advaita Acharya, she pleaded with him. Advaita Acharya, you know, you are a universal mother. And he went in ecstasy glorifying her and he fell unconscious. She took his lust and then Lord Chaitanya blessed her. By the agency of Srivas Pandit, of course, Leela, she is also a great personality, incarnation of Yashoda. But all this tells us how a devotee is so important in the eyes of the Lord. Nothing else impresses the Lord except the devotion of a devotee and the personality of a devotee. Then Gopal Chappal, another envious person, you know, was not allowed entry in the house of Srivas Pandit for the ecstatic Nagar, ecstatic Haridam Sankirtan. So he put wine, flesh and all the paraphernalia of Devi worship, which is a condemnable activity for a Vaishnava to do. Vaishnava will never respect all the devotees, all the demigods, but never enter into worship and spend time in worshipping. But all these paraphernalia, as if Srivas Pandit is secretly worshipping Goddess Durga, was put in the courtyard of Srivas Pandit. And what happened? Srivas Pandit was not offended. He said, yeah, actually this is the truth. I'm trying to show I'm a devotee, a Vaishnav, but actually this is the real thing. He has explored, so this is a fact. And everybody else came and cleared that and put Gangajal and put Gomutra and cleaned the whole thing. But Lord Chaitanya doesn't tolerate offenses to his devotees, although his devotees may tolerate and accept whatever it is. Soon enough, Gopal Chappal got leprosy. So I asked one time Gurudev, is it that everybody who offends Vaishnava get leprosy? He said, no, whatever is incurable at that moment of time currently happens to people. That time leprosy was incurable. Leprosy was like you die, that's all. So that time everybody got leprosy. Today one may get something else. So Lord Chaitanya one time saw this leper, Gopal Chapala, suffering, you know, on the ground. Something called lepromatous leprosy, the worst type of leprosy. And he was crying and begging for mercy. Lord Chaitanya chastised him. He said, you deserve this because you offended my devotee. Try to defame my devotee who is a pure devotee of mine. I will not forgive you. You have to go and beg forgiveness from Srivas. So he went to Srivas, and Srivas actually very kindly and very gently forgave him, as if nothing happened. And that time the leprosy went away of Gopal Chapal. Till the time he didn't gather his courage to reach Srivas Thakur and beg forgiveness and surrender at his feet, he suffered leprosy. I mean, did that, finally he got cured. Then one time in the Sankirtan, in the house of Srivas Pandit, one cannot imagine to be in this situation like that. His own son died. You just try to imagine those of Grahasthas here. Some lecture is happening in your house, some deity welcome, some ceremony, Grah Pravesh, something happening, and a great devotee has come, everybody is enjoying, eating prasad and dancing kirtan, and your son dies. And imagine what we would do if that happens. And that happened in the middle of ecstatic, tumultuous kirtan, which was overwhelming the whole universe, you know, overwhelming the hearts of devotees, flooding them with ecstasy as never before. In that crescendo, the son died. And he sensed that. So immediately ran in the antapur inside, where all the ladies are gathered in the dead body of his son. They were crying. He said, you don't cry loudly. Please understand this. I am warning you. Do not cry. If you want to cry, cry in your hearts. Don't cry with your mouth and make sound. If you make some sound, Lord Gauranga will get disturbed. And his Sankirtan activity will be disturbed. I do not want to happen. Do you understand? So all of them just, they are so sad and they are, can't cry also. And then soon, little later, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Lord Gauranga felt some uneasiness. Said, what happened? So no, my Lord, nothing happened. You please continue. No, tell me what happened. No, everything is all right. Please tell me. No, everything is fine. Please continue. No, Srivas, tell me what happened. My Lord, my son died. Really? Why didn't you tell me earlier? Take me to the place where your son is. She brought the dead body is there. And everybody came. Lord Chaitanya felt so bad. He called the son, the soul back, and asked some questions. So he said, which parents? He said, look at your parents, they are so sad because you left. So which parents are you talking about, my Lord? I had many, many parents. And the personality spoke some very beautiful philosophical things. And then, by receiving the glorious, merciful darshan of Lord Gauranga, that soul went back to Godhead happily. And even Srivas got pacified. But at that very moment, when all this happened, because see, if Dukhi and a Muslim tailor is getting delivered, what about the son, very son of Srivas? He had to get delivered. So he got delivered back to Godhead. But at that moment of time, just before that, that event had happened where the students of Nimai Pandit, you know, started criticizing him because he was in seclusion, in ecstasy, chanting the names of gopis. And they said, this is not a bona fide teacher. This is not the way to chant. We are supposed to chant Gopal's name. And you are chanting the ladies' names. This is not fair. So Lord Chaitanya, in that ecstasy of gopi bhav, got angry and took a stick and chased the boys away. Then he came back to normalcy and thought, oh, if I continue like this in a grahastha form, nobody will take me seriously. They'll make fun of me. And my bhav and my mercy, how will I distribute? So I think I must take sannyas, because then sannyasi people will respect, bow down to, and automatically, because I am supreme personality of Godhead, they will bow down. As a sannyasi also, they will get great benefit and they will all get delivered. So he was contemplating about sannyas. And at this event, when this happened, looking at Srivasa's mood, Lord Chaitanya felt, how will I be able to leave the company of people like Srivas? What a compliment. It's manogat, it's not spoken loudly. Lord just took a pause and went little aside and thought like this. Srivas is such a lovable devotee, such a surrendered soul, such a devotee of mine. I am thinking of taking sannyas to deliver the whole world. But what about myself? How will I be able to give up the company of Srivas? That much dear Srivas was to the Lord. And later on, when the son left actually, Sivas was feeling bad, his son left. Lord Chaitanya told him, me and Lord Nityananda are your sons, do not worry. Like Gopinath said to, what is his name? In Agradvipa, the three brothers, Vasudev, Govind and Gopal Ghosh. One of them was the worshipper of Radha Gopinath there. When his son died, and Gopinath said, I am your son. He said, who will do my Shraddha? The Lord said, I will do your Shraddha when you die. Don't worry. And Lord did his Shraddha. Same way Lord is excelling Srivas Pandit here. Me and Nityananda will be your sons. Don't worry. And then finally Lord took sannyas. And Srivas Pandit was very, very disappointed to have lost the company of Lord Gauranga, his beloved. So out of, you know, they just, it's like this, you know, when Nityananda Prabhu left Eka Chakra, majority of the villagers left Eka Chakra because they just couldn't live in the same place where they had enjoyed with Nityananda Prabhu and had pastimes. And so each place would give them pain of remembrance that, oh, here we did this, here we played in Jamuna, here we did this, here he jumped, here all the boys fell unconscious. So they just couldn't bear the memory of what they had with Nityananda. So they just left everybody to unknown places except for 2-3 Brahmins. So like that, Srivas Pandit couldn't bear the separation from the Lord. So he moved from there to Kumarhatta. And he said that on the way to Vrindavan, Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu visited Kumarhatta. And there he asked a very beautiful question. I previously thought that it happened in Navadvip, but it's not happened in Navadvip, it happened in Kumarhatta. And the Lord asked the Srivas Pandit in Kumarhatta that how did you maintain yourself? I don't see you working. You're always at home serving devotees, chanting, dancing, ecstasy. How do you maintain yourself? You're a grahastha, you have family, you have a house. Said, my Lord, I clap 3 times. You can clap. 1, 2, 3. Hare Krishna. And if I don't get my resources, I will tie a stone in my neck and commit suicide in Ganga. Looking at the conviction of Srivas Pandit, Lord said, Lakshmi Devi may, on an unfortunate day in the future, Lakshmi Devi may need to go with a bowl to beg. A time may come like that. But Srivas, I bless you. Your house will never be bereft of any resources. It will be always filled with resources. I bless you. This is a kind of faith, you know. That doesn't mean we also need to clap and wait. We have to do our duty. We are not as on the level of Srivas. But the essence of this clapping and the statement and the pastime we can gather is that the faith that avashya rakshibe Krishna. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Amara palan bhara ekhona tomara. I am simply depending on you. I may be a magistrate, millionaire, influential and big things. I have so many servants and property. But at the level of the heart, he is thinking, I am dependent on you and my palana bhara is ekhona tomar. This is your prerogative to maintain me. I am simply surrendered to you. So we may have business, we have a lot of money, investment, this and that. But at the heart of our hearts, we should think that these all investments and all these things can be destroyed in the moment, you know. One country will leave some union and things will crash here, things will crash there. Bomb blast will take place, some atomic war will take place. And where is our papers? You have papers? My papers? Where are my papers, Prabhuji? I gave papers, mutual fund. Where are the papers? There is nothing. Final our, sorry to say, Prabhuji. Finally, our heart has to have dependence on Sri Krishna. That He will maintain us, He will look after us. And whatever, at whatever times we will need, He will look after us. And it has, he has proved several times in the lives of devotees that He is there and He somehow miraculously does the kshema and kushal of devotees. Yoga kshemam vahami aham. I look after the kshema and yoga of my devotees. And we have to have faith in this statement. So we do all our duties, you know. With the help of Anand Vrindavan Prabhu, we do all our securities, but we know our real security is Sri Krishna. Avaksha Rakshibe Krishna, He will take care of us. And the real protection of Sri Krishna, the real provision of His is remembrance of Himself when we need the most. That is His real resource provision. The provision of resource, real one, is what you need at the most needful hour of your life is the memory, remembrance of Sri Krishna. And that is what also He will give. If you depend on Him, He will be the person who will give you remembrance and not our efforts of whole life of sadhana which will yield to the remembrance. Please understand. It's like the squirrel, we do our best, 100%, but that will not yield by qualification the remembrance of Krishna, but Sri Krishna will bestow upon us His remembrance. And we have to have faith on that. If we live with this faith, then Sri Krishna out of love will be obliged to give us remembrance. And that is only hope that we have got. That is the essence of life of Srivas Pandit. So we offer our most humble, most surrendered, most prostrated dandavat pranams to Srivas Pandit and beg Him that He gives iota of His mood to all of us. Whether we are Griha Thako, Vanne Thako, whether we are Brahmacharis or Vanprastha, that mood of Srivas Pandit of utter dependence on Krishna should come in iota form in our heart. Our life will be successful. Srivas Pandit Mahashoy ki, Pancha Tattva ki, Srivas Angan ki, Lakshmana Devi ki, Dwarkadish Krishna Bhagavan ki, Hare Krishna.